We've been coming to Tanglewood for 25 years.
Oh, 35 years.
Oh, 15 years.
46 years.
There's something about this place that's just so energizing.
There's a quality in the music that is all a part of nature.
Sometimes I'm talking to them about music. Sometimes I'm talking to them about the specialness of the music that they're playing.
The composer had to do something to get all of us to feel that same way.
Sometimes, though, when I'm talking to kids, I might be using that very same music to talk to them about what it means for their life.
Oh, man, isn't that cool? That is so cool.
Vic Firth is undoubtedly one of the most well-renowned orchestral musicians of all time, certainly in the percussion realm.
He was frustrated with the sticks that he could find on the market. So he started making his own sticks.
We've been coming to Tanglewood for 25 years.
Oh, 35 years.
Oh, 15 years.
46 years.
About 50 years.
Yay. His very first concert. How do you like it, Brooks?
Phenomenal.
The place is great.
It's like a spa.
Can't get enough of the place. I can't get enough live music. I love the BSO and I love the Boston Pops.
The gift of the property called Tanglewood, which is 120 plus acres, was made by the Tappan family. And that was basically the core Tanglewood until the mid-1980s, when the opportunity came to purchase the adjoining property, the Harding family estate. Somewhere along the line, we acquired the estate owned by Sergei Kuzovitsky called Saranac. We now have about 526 acres in total. There's something about this place that's just so energizing.
There's a quality in the music that is all a part of nature.
The combination of this fantastic landscape, the clarity of the sky, great energy of the musicians, especially of the students who come to study, who are full of youthful brim, and I think that's what really sustains us for so long.
We have about 150 young people that come here every year to study and collaborate. A student who arrives at the Tanglewood Music Center, depending on what their particular area of study is, has very, very intense interactions, certainly with the resident faculty that we have at the Music Center, but also with the musicians of the Boston Symphony. One of Kuzovitsky's genius ideas in starting the TMC was not just the passing of a baton from generation to generation, which is wonderful enough, but he also realized how energizing it is for the musicians of the Boston Symphony to be in a mentor relationship with their young colleagues. And it energizes the orchestra, and it makes the orchestra sound that much better.
My first year with the BSO, it's my first year at Tanglewood. So I took the audition 3 times, and it's because I really, really wanted to be in this orchestra. And now that I have tenure, it's incredible to think I can actually be a part of it for who knows how many years now.
Each week, the orchestra plays 3 programs. We have to plan those programs. The concerts happen in the shed, which is a very large venue. It's almost 5,000 undercover. And then we have the possibility for about another 10,000 or so on the lawn. So we have to try and find programs that are appealing to the widest possible audience.
I am here to see E.T., one of the all-time greats.
They're showing the movie on the projector,
and the orchestra is playing.
And the music is playing.
myself as an adventure seeker this afternoon, traveling through the landscape of your own body.
This is Kids Corner, and we try to align our crafts to relate to the concert that the orchestra is practicing today, and also we're here at the Sunday concerts. And we just try to make it fun, and we like to connect visual arts with the music. Today we're inspired by Beethoven. At that table we're making Beethoven masks, and at this table we were inspired by the Ives piece, which is the Housatonic River at Stockbridge. So we're doing musical landscapes. Isn't that great? So we're just being inspired by the music today.
One of the things that makes Tanglewood absolutely unique is that we all transport our lives here for the course of at least 8 weeks, and we do live as a community.
It clearly is the engine that drives the tourist bus.
Tanglewood is extremely important for the local businesses. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for Tanglewood.
It's a very symbiotic relationship.
It's a win-win situation. They're here, so we have good business, but we give back to Tanglewood by coming and promoting Tanglewood.
It's fascinating to see the maestros, see the conductors, see these public figures in an intimate setting and someplace where they feel at home. Talk about humility. John is the kind of person who will call up and say, "Hi, this is John Williams." First of all, he's making his own reservation. Second of all, he would say, "I'm only one, but I'll be quick." And I say, "John, really, we'd like you to stay and linger as long as you would like."
We raised our kids here. My girls are now 28 and 31 years old, and they live on the West Coast. But when they come home, the first thing we do is plan a Tanglewood picnic.
I just walked in here for the first time in almost 6 years, and I had this flood of memories coming back of every summer coming here with my family.
Growing up, we were always at many different concerts, and now I live in Concord and come all the time.
He actually proposed to me here July 7th, 2007.
What better place to spend it with the family, the whole family?
Yes, it's a family tradition. We come every year. So thank you very much, Boston Symphony Orchestra.
You walk around these grounds at Tanglewood, and you realize who was here before. Kuzubitsky, who was the founder of Tanglewood, Aaron Copland, Leonard Bernstein, they're all sort of here. Their spirits are here everywhere.
We're living in times when there's a tremendous amount of sort of static going on in the world. This is a place where you can somehow incubate yourself from all of that.
Hey, it's Janet Wu here. So excited. It will be lead up to the free Boston Symphony Boston Pops concert in Franklin Park. I have Thomas Wilkins here. He's the youth and family concerts conductor. So many kids are going to be here today. So we want to get your take a little bit on what they can expect.
I think if they've never heard the orchestra before, if they're anything like I was when I was a kid, they're going to be blown away by the sheer force.
I was 8 years old. My third grade class got on a bus to hear something called the Norfolk Symphony Orchestra. I remember the experience because I remember everything that happened in the beginning. You know, there's all these group of people with these instruments. And then this man comes out with, you know, this striking presence. And the orchestra stands up, and with the exception of the cellos and the bassoons, and they played the national anthem. And I had heard that before, but never in the voice of an orchestra. And so at that moment, I'm hooked, totally, you know, toast. And so for the whole rest of the program, I'm staring at the orchestra and staring at this man, at his movements, and his emotional slash visceral involvement with the sound that I was hearing. And I just walked away from that experience saying, that's where I want to be, in that spot. Seventh grade, my teacher in string orchestra said, who wants to try to conduct the orchestra? Bam, hand went up, you know. Wow. So that was the first time that I actually had a chance to get in front of people. I'd had a chance to conduct before because I used to take my little green army soldiers and set them up like an orchestra and conduct them in my bedroom when nobody was watching. I used to joke and tell people my first job was I had a military band.
You know what I love about you being here? I think it's the coolest thing we hear. Don't get me wrong. I love doing concerts for grown-ups. You know, they come at night, they get all dressed up, they go to dinner and all that stuff, and then they walk in, we play Beethoven, Brahms, and Mozart, and Haydn. I love it, though, when you're here.
When I'm talking to an audience, I want them to have fun.
You know why I love it?
I'm not talking to them because I want them to think I'm smart, or learned, or sophisticated. I want to talk to them so they go, all right, okay, then show me what you got.
Hey, watch this.
Sometimes I'm talking to them about music. Sometimes I'm talking to them about the specialness of the music that they're playing.
So here's what I want you to do. You could agree, for example, that whatever your words are, somehow what you heard was exciting, yes? Exhilarating, yes? Breathtaking, yes? Well, the composer had to do something to get all of us to feel that same way.
Sometimes, though, when I'm talking to kids, I might be using that very same music to talk to them about what it means for their life, for their everyday life. And making that parallel and that translation is, you know, this is no different from you trying to be a better friend, or this partnership that you've created in this string quartet, that's no different from you being a good family member or a contributor to your community, or the same degree of tenacity that's required for you to learn this B flat scale. It's the same degree of tenacity you need to turn to your math homework.
And we discovered that decision-making starts with choice. And choice is born from inspiration. And if you were here with us last
And let's be honest, sometimes I'm going into a situation where kids look like me and have the same life that I had as a background growing up, single mother, welfare, housing project. That gives me a little street cred, you know? Kid who is in that situation can't look at me and say, yeah, you're a conductor of the Boston Symphony Orchestra, but you have no idea what my life is like. Wrong.
You know, we call this program today, by the way, Sound Decisions, because we have to figure out what are the decisions that a composer, the person who writes the music for the orchestra, what are the decisions that they have to make in order to create that sound?
All of us who are grown-ups need to be more dogged about surrounding our young children to give them an opportunity to grow up whole. But certainly there are neighborhoods where I have more freedom to tell them the raw truth sometimes. I lived in a housing project, and I come back and I'm telling people I want to be a conductor, and nobody said, no, young black boys don't grow up to be conductors. Maybe you should choose something else. Nobody said that to me. I even had people say to me, wow, then all right, then you're gonna be the first black Leonard Bernstein, you know? How did they even know who Leonard Bernstein was, for crying out loud, you know? There are moments, and it still happens, there are moments in music where I just weep because I know that that music has grabbed me in a place, or it's stirred me in a way that has caused this physical reaction in me. But it could be emotional, it could be psychological, it could be that it sparked a memory, or that it is for me, a moment of gratitude that I get to participate in something this incredible, and I'm humbled by it, and so that causes me to weep.
Oh man, isn't that cool? That is so cool. And to make it even better, you're thinking to yourself, hey, that sounds like a groove. I didn't know orchestras could groove. I didn't realize that.
I think a groove is a groove is a groove. And I think the last movement of Beethoven's 7 grooves of it just doesn't groove like this, you know?
Katz. I'm a cellist in the Boston Symphony Orchestra since 2004. I have a passion for cooking, so when I'm not working, very often what I'll do is I'll either cook something, shop for it, or just plan. I think there's something similar between music and food, that we're so visually, our sense of vision is so dominant that taste, sound, and smells, they connect much more to us on an emotional level than I think in a way that words can't get to you. Cooking, the creative process, I think, is similar to making music. You have ingredients and you, you really have to improvise more than, we're classical musicians, so we don't improvise much. But still, the interpretation of a recipe is like a like interpretation of a score of music. In the last few years, I've turned Asian pretty much. Study a lot of Chinese cooking and Japanese and Thai and Vietnamese and Malaysian. No one in my family will agree to eat rabbit, so there's no point in cooking it because it's too cute. And I kept saying, you know, pigs are cute too. That's not really the point. Tonight's my birthday. I'm not cooking.
The percussion obviously is always in the back. We are running around back there, around one another, and therefore we have to have a certain amount of communication that maybe some of the other sections don't have to have. And the one thing about our section, I think, that would be unique is that we work together in a way that maybe the string sections and the other sections of the orchestra don't.
Percussionists are more
the backbone of the orchestra a little bit in a rhythmical sense.
Vic Firth is undoubtedly one of the most well-renowned orchestral musicians of all time, certainly in the percussion realm. I would argue that he's the most well-known percussionist of all time.
I was amazed with his ability to make music on the timpani, and I think I learned more from watching him play than I learned from any school that I went to.
It was clear to everyone that heard him play that timpani was definitely Vic's calling.
His connection with the Boston Symphony is obvious. His 50 years with the orchestra, 48 of them as the principal timpanist, and frankly, developed his company from working in the orchestra.
As he played timpani with the orchestra, he was frustrated with the sticks that he could find on the market. So he bought a lathe and started making his own sticks in his basement. Others started finding out that he was producing a high quality of stick and started asking him if he could produce sticks for them, both classical players and drum set players.
From those very humble beginnings, we now have multiple buildings here in Newport, Maine, where we have well over 180,000 square foot facility.
Have evolved a process over years that takes into account the properties of the wood, wood science, and the volumes we have to operate at. It has resulted in a very complex process that produces a very, very high quality drum set.
Whether it's rock, concert, jazz, world percussion, marching, the best of the best wanted to work with Vic.
I remember when I got my first pair of Vic Firth sticks, I think I was 15 years old. I still have those sticks. I never broke them. I think the rest of the orchestra looks at our section perhaps a little differently than the other.
We are an anomaly, I think, compared to most percussion sections because we all really get along.
It's a very fun job to have. It changes from week to week. The instruments that we play change from week to week. Sometimes we're playing instruments we've never played before, which is sometimes a bit of a unique challenge. Overall, yes, I would say that our jobs in the percussion section are pretty fun.
I was always drawn to the sound of the trumpet. It's such a brilliant and pure sound, and growing up, my favorite movies to watch were Steven Spielberg movies with John Williams scores, and he uses the trumpet so amazingly well, but also in a very versatile way. So it would be either heroic or scary or beautiful and majestic. So, you know, the brilliance of the sound, but also how many different ways the trumpet could be used, I think, is what kind of lured me in as a young 9-10 year old who wanted to be involved in music, and made it kind of an easy decision. Greatest things about music generally and performing music is it's never a stagnant process. You've never finally made it, because if you get to that point and you try to coast, most importantly, you're probably gonna fall out of love with what you're doing, but also there are so many different things that you have to keep up on a day-to-day basis: slurs, articulation, dynamics, sound, that one thing can go by the wayside very quickly. You do come to the concerts and you see what we do, and the concert lasts a couple hours and then we leave, and hopefully if we're doing our job correctly, you don't notice that anything was difficult. You just came and enjoyed the music. You didn't hear us miss a note or anything out of tune or out of balance. The drama of the music is what lured me in, kind of in my final stages, to say, like, yeah, absolutely, this is what I want to do for a living.
Thank you. To learn more about the Boston Symphony Orchestra, please visit www.bso.org.